right.
Success. I don't trust the thoughts that come inside my head. I don't trust this thing that beats inside my chest. Who I am and who I want to be cannot connect. Why? Don't think I deserve it, you get no respect. I just made a couple mils, they're not impressed. Let you down goes triple platinum, yeah, okay, okay, I guess. Smile for a moment, then these questions starting to fill my head, not again. I push away the people that I love the most. Why? I don't want no one to know I'm vulnerable. Why? That makes me feel weak and so uncomfortable. Why? Stop asking me questions, I just want to feel alive until I die. This is an ace flow, just let me rhyme. I'm in disguise. I'm a busy person, got no time for lies. One of a kind, they don't see it, I pull out their eyes. I'm on a rise. I've been doing this for most of my life with no advice. Take my chances, I just roll the dice. Do what I like. As a kid, I was afraid of highs. Put that aside, now I'm here and they look so surprised. What's on my wall? Don't invite me to the parties, but I still arrive. Kick down the door and then I go inside. Give off that I do not belong here vibe. Then take the keys right off the counter and let's go for a ride. Why do y'all look mortified? I keep to myself, they think I'm sorta shy. Organized, let you down's the only song you've heard of. Well, then you're behind. Story time, wish that I could think like Big Sean does, but I just can't decide if I should stick my knife inside a Pennywise. I don't care what anybody else thinks. Lies, I do not need nobody to help me. Lies, I kinda feel guilty cause I'm wealthy. Why? I don't understand, it's got me questioning like why. Just tell me why, not back to this flow inside. I feel divided, back when I ain't had a dime but I had to drive, back before I ever signed. I question life, like who am I, man? Whoa! Nothing to me's ever good enough. I could be working for 24 hours a day and think I never did enough. My life is a movie, but there ain't no telling what you're gonna see in my cinema. I wanna be great, but I get in the way of myself and I think about everything that I could never be. Why do I do it though? Hey, yeah. Why you always looking aggravated? Not a choice, you know I had to make it. When they talk about the greatest, they gon' probably never put us in a conversation. Like something, then I gotta take it. Write something, then I might erase it. I love it, then I really hate it. What's the problem, nigga? I don't know. I know I like to preach to always be yourself, but my emotions make me feel like I am someone else. Me and pride have made a pact that we don't need no help, which feels like I'm at war inside myself, but I forgot the shells. I hope
Justin Boyd, what is up, my friend?
Hey, morning. How are you doing?
Good, good.
Good.
I got my camo, little rough shave going on here.
Yeah, I like it.
it's Friday, right?
That's right. That's right. You made it. You made it through the week.
Yeah, man. So we got about 30 minutes before you got to jump on a call with a client. So we'll jump straight into it.
Yeah, that's right.
I appreciate you being here. For those of you that don't know Justin Boyd, I'll let him do his own introduction, but he is my CFO and he's completely changed our trajectory, and I could not be more excited to have him as part of our team. So Justin Boyd, tell us a little bit about you.
Yeah, well, first of all, he gives me too much credit for his recent successes. He's done a lot of work and a lot of the grinding himself, so I'm just kind of a touch point. So he's done a lot of good stuff, but I'm a fractional CFO for small businesses. So essentially what that means is, you know, businesses that aren't big enough to hire their own full-time CFO, but need that strategic help every month to help them get to know their numbers, to forecast, to plan, to do things the right way with taxes, et cetera. Everything in the CFO relationship, I help small businesses do that. And so you don't need me 40 hours a week. So I pop in, we do our thing, and I'm able to help a lot of different clients that way. My background, I guess I was in personal finance, helped families and small businesses with investments and insurance and different things like that. And then I moved on to lending, did that with Wells Fargo for a little while, Wells Fargo Financial, and then they actually closed down Nationwide. And so I was like, okay, I don't want to go work in a bank. That's not what I went to school for. Nothing wrong with that. But I wanted something different. So my biggest tenure is I took a job at IBM and stayed there for about 11 years, actually. So kind of climbed the corporate ladder, so to speak, and did everything from, you know, planning and budgeting for a $300 million portfolio for software group to eventually pricing the North America Systems E mainframe servers, designing the pricing strategy for that, and assisting the sales team. And then eventually got into cloud pricing, where we were competing against Amazon, Google, et cetera, which was a lot of fun.
Yeah, I'm going to be dead honest with you. I have no idea what you just said.
Yeah, that's okay.
No idea what you just said.
Corporate mumbo jumbo, but yeah.
It sounds very important and above my pay grade.
Yeah, so it was good. They treated me well. It was a really great time. Ultimately, I needed a change, and it was a good opportunity. I learned a ton, and they treated me very well again, but I felt a little underutilized, you know, a small fish in a big pond kind of a thing. And I wanted to see the whole picture end to end and have more of an impact and really, you know, get my hands in there and not just have a bunch of meetings and have a lot of people on a call and nothing really get accomplished. Right. So, so I was getting a little burned out. So I eventually took a couple different CFO gigs, for a single company, you know, full-time CFO, for a cabinet company, about a $10 million cabinet company out of Tennessee, and then a little tenure with the real estate development company down in Florida. But ultimately it was the same thing. I was like, I'm just helping one company, and I want to be able to help a lot of different companies, because I feel a sense of there's a lot of small businesses out there that are underserved. They're not getting this sort of, you know, high level planning, really the quality and the quantity of planning that they need. They don't have access to. So how do I take what I've done and make it available to a bunch of different people that, you know, can't afford or can't access that level of strategic planning. So that's kind of where this whole thing was born. And I really have a passion for helping people. I want to help as many people as I can. And the nice thing is I can share best practices between my clients and really get an idea of, you know, what things look like, what things are supposed to look like. And I help them, you know, I help them using each other's data. So, it's been good.
So I met, Dan Plata at Sales Boost, and we were talking about you briefly, and, he said, I guess you went to school together, right?
We did. Yeah. Yep. Yeah.
He said that you were the genius in the class, and he just kind of skated by.
Yeah. That's the story he always tells. Yeah. And he's like, again, he's underselling himself, because he's a super smart dude, and he went on a bunch of different degrees and, you know, just education crazy guy. But, yeah, he always jokes about copying off my sheets and whatever. I think he had more fun. He had more fun in college than I did. So he got the best of both worlds. But I was more of a good student. Yeah.
I think he's still having fun. I'm pretty sure beer is a significant aspect of his life.
It is. It's a signature. Yeah. Every convention he goes to, he's got beer at his booth, and that's a big part of who he is. So
He was drinking beer while doing his presentation. It was pretty funny.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So
definitely the opposite of what I think of when I think of Justin Boyd. Polished. That's Justin Boyd.
Yeah, right.
Polished.
No, I wish.
So we met, just to give some background, we met in Nashville at the Huge.
We did. Yep.
And I walked past your booth and I read it and I thought, man, I could use somebody like that. So we talked for a few minutes and I think you thought I was completely full of it, but that's okay. I followed up with you you know, you go to these events and people say, oh yeah, I'm going to call you. And they never do. Right. But, I immediately knew that there was a connection and that this was going to work out for us. And, for those of you that don't understand how this works, Justin is my CFO, right? But he is, he's a 1099. So basically he's a consultant for my company. And he helps with, the big thing we're working on now is KPIs. So maybe that's a good segue into, kind of how you do that.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think, it's ultimately, you know, kind of going back to what business owners need is a lot of them either don't know their numbers or they spend too much time, you know, figuring out their numbers. And so, a few of the core staple things that I do with all my clients is we do KPI tracking, which is, for those of you who don't know what it is, it's called key performance indicators is what it stands for, but it's really taking a snapshot of a bunch of different areas of your business to do kind of a health check. So when you go, you know, get a blood test, there's a dozen different things that come back, and you don't know what half of them are, but they're all important to some degree, right? And so, and they all have to work together. So, you know, we look at liquidity and your debt structure and your profitability and your efficiency with different activities and different parts of the business. And so it's just, it's making sure everything clicks, because a lot of business owners will just focus on one area of their business, whether it's revenue or, you know, cash or debt or whatever, and they'll kind of neglect the rest of it. And so it's really, it's we're able to keep an eye and a pulse on everything at the same time to make sure when we're pressing on something, it's not making something, you know, more unhealthy. Right. You know, we're making something healthy over here, but then it's unhealthy over there. And then it's also, we have the ability to track it over time to see if we're getting better. And we can also benchmark against, you know, what the industry standard should be. So that's a big part of what we do. And then the other thing is forecasting. Bookkeeping is great. It's very necessary, but it's very backward looking and reactive. And so how do we project the future based on our past and based on new things that we know are going to happen in the business? And then test different things. What if we, you know, bought a new truck and extended our crew? What if we opened a new location? What if we took on debt and bought this other building? What if we hired a new salesperson and paid him commission? And how does that affect revenue and expenses? And so we can sort of map that out and test it ahead of time, right, in a safe space. So we can see what that looks like before we actually make that decision. So it's a way to be proactive and use the data that we have to make decisions for the future.
Right. So I believe this full-heartedly. It's the most genius businessmen of our time were men that knew how to delegate, specifically delegate areas that they're not experts in.
Right.
So that's right, kind of where I'm focusing my time right now. I'm finding people and surrounding myself with people that I know are great at what they do. So that's why when I walked by your booth, it was just like a magnet. I said, okay, yeah, this guy's got something that I could use. And we dove into it. And just quite frankly, there's zero chance, and you already know this because you spent some significant time cleaning my books. There's zero chance that I could do this part of the business without help.
Right. Right.
And most people, specifically in my industry, the pressure washing industry, you're in that same boat, because let's face it, if you're starting a pressure washing company, you don't have a degree in business, most likely. You don't have, you know, financial backing or financial systems or education. You're probably just a go-getter, right? You know how to make, you know how to make a dollar. So you really need somebody like you to keep us in check. Like you said, it's very easy for me to just go out and buy another truck because it feels right. Well, that's what Justin Boyd's here for. I'll send him a text and say, Justin, I'm about to buy a truck. And he'll say, don't do it. You know? So
yeah.
Justin's job, full-time job, is to keep me in check.
Yeah, right. And yeah, contrary to popular belief, it's not always a no, but yeah, it's like, hey, let's look at that. Let's, you know, let's see how that looks. But yeah, for sure. I don't want to say that small business owners don't have a great finance background, because a lot of them do. A lot of them have a very strong finance background, whether it's, you know, they might have had an education in it, or they might have just kind of learned it over time through coaching and different things like that. But kind of where I come from is you either do have an education, and, you know, whether it's formal or informal, and you don't have time to do it, though. Your time is more valuable running the business and being that go-getter, getting customers, you know, making sure your customers are happy, making sure your team is happy and doing well, and being the strategic CEO and visionary of the company, right? And so that is a much higher dollar per hour value than what a fun, you know, digging into your numbers would be. So even if you know how to do it, even if you think you have a great handle on it, you still shouldn't be spending the time doing that, because it's not the best place, right? So it goes back to that book where it's, you know, who, not how. Don't figure out how to do it yourself, all these things. Find someone who can do it better, and then you go spend your time on higher value things. And then the other camp of people, yeah, they don't have that knowledge in the background, and they just need someone to come in and help provide that structure. So it's not all gut feel when they're making decisions.
Who was the author of that book?
I forget. I should know. Yeah, but it's great. It's a great book. And it's all about how do I exactly what you're doing? This, the smartest people in the world surround themselves with people that are better at things than they are. For instance, I'm not great at social media. But I'm not going to go out there and figure out how to do everything better and how to, you know, clip videos and, you know, what kind of light do I need and where do I post it when? It's like, no, I don't have time for that. And it would take me away from my core competency. And it doesn't make sense. It's not going to help me grow my business, right? So just find someone that knows how to do it and just take it off your plate. It's a lot of mental energy as well that is taken off your plate, that you can sleep well knowing that someone's got a handle on this. They're looking at it and they're sort of a checkpoint.
I spent so much time in the beginning. You know, this is 2002. So this is my 21st year being an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
I spent easily the first decade trying to do everything. I was just of the mindset that I can handle anything you throw at me. I'm going to do it better than you can anyway. So just give me a day. I'm going to learn that system and it'll be fine.
Yep.
Right. Well, what I've discovered in that is that, number one, I'm dead wrong. I'm just dead wrong. And there's a lot of things I'm just not good at. Right. So focus on what you're good at. Double down on that. I think that was a, Gary Vaynerchuk, thing, you know, Gary V.
Yeah.
He loves to talk about that. You know, everybody says you need to improve on the things you're not good at. That's just not true.
Yeah.
Hire somebody else to do that for you.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, segues into, I just hired a VA. So that's got to be added to my expenses. We're going to have to do a projection. I should have called you first. But
VA, can we talk offline, Trevor, real quick?
the VA is going to take over my social media content and that kind of stuff because I found that I am good at it. I'm good at the graphic design and that kind of stuff. But I've discovered that I'm spending far too much time on it. So it's time to delegate that.
Yep.
Even though I enjoy it, but sometimes you have to do that.
It is tough. Yeah. And I struggle with the same thing in my business where it's, I'm a very hands-on person and I'm like, well, if I want it done right, I need to do it myself and I need to, you know, so I still struggle with that too, in terms of what, you know, when can I delegate this to staff and, you know, do some of those things so I can just look at the more high level picture and just kind of come in when the dirty stuff needs to get done, you know, when the tough decisions and the tough analysis need to be done. So, yeah, for sure. It's definitely if you try to do everything, you try to be a jack of all trades, you'll be mediocre at everything. Right. And that's not what's going to make you successful. So, there's not enough hours in the day and there's too many things going on and it's changing too fast to be an expert at everything. And to have the time to do everything and still try to manage a personal life, you know, have a healthy work-life balance and not get burned out and be there for the people around you that are important. So it's definitely, you're on the right path. And that's, you know, everyone needs to keep striving for that every day in terms of delegating and growing your core competency.
It's interesting. You said, you know, things are changing so fast. That's not something you think about. As far as, you know, aspects of your business, you've got marketing, admin, CEO services, financial stuff, the things that, you know, the top or the general areas of your business. So you might spend a lot of time on marketing and get really good at it. And then, okay, you kind of put that over here, compartmentalize and move on. Yep. And then you start working on the finances, a couple months go by and you're like, oh, there's this whole new thing I've got to learn, TikTok, right? I've got to learn TikTok now. And so that's a good point that everything's changing. Like I could talk about software programs till I'm blue in the face.
Yep.
But if I stepped away from, you know, paying attention to new implementations and new software programs for 1 year, if I did that for 1 year, I'd be left in the back, you know? Yep. And so you really just have to, Melody Edwards said, it's not who, what, how, it's who, not how. I guess I did that wrong. Thanks, Melody.
Yeah. Who, not how. Yep. Yep.
Yeah. There we go. Hey, Melody, who wrote that book? Help us out here. Maybe an Amazon link so the viewers can check that book out.
Yeah.
Putting you to work, Melody.
Yeah.
Anyway, tell us about your personal life. You said you're married and you have children, so tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, so I have a wife of it's 16 years now. It's crazy. It's flown by. She's amazing. She's very multi-talented musician. She homeschools our kids.
Oh my
She's
gosh.
been the worship leader at our church. Yeah,
God bless
bless
her.
her, right? Yeah. She's the person that, manages all of the kids' activities and our social calendar and everything. And she's, super, super human, basically, like most moms out there. So I couldn't do without her. And she's at the same time, helping me and motivating me and, having patience for me as I grow the business. So it's great. Yeah, we have three awesome kids, two girls and a boy, 12, 9, and 7, and two dogs. So we definitely stay busy, but we enjoy traveling as well. That's a big part of, as I'm growing my business, that's a big part of what I value is how do I, help people that are not bound by physically being near me where we have to meet, using technology to be able to meet people remotely, but it also allows me the ability to travel and we kind of can go where we want when we want. So we have an RV and we're a big traveling family. Just like to see new things and have the kids experience new things. So that's a big part of what we
That's what I was gonna say. I was gonna say, true or false, the Boyds did live in an RV for a period of time.
Yes, we did. Absolutely. Yep.
That's wild, man. Three
Yeah.
kids and two dogs in an RV.
Yeah.
I can't
Yeah.
fathom.
I never thought it would happen either. I'm not the adventurous type as much as my wife. I'm becoming more like that. Besides our Europe trip, we haven't done anything crazy like that, but working remote and during COVID, it was just like, okay, and coming into the winter in Minnesota, it was like, this is the time to do it if we're gonna ever do it. So it was a blast. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, by the way, is a trip to the Bahamas a write-off for clean image? I'm trying to figure out.
Yeah.
No?
Maybe. Depends on what you do
Maybe.
down there, I guess. But yeah.
All
Yeah.
right. Well,
Yeah. We could work that in somehow. Yeah. Yep. But
you know this is live, right?
yes. Yeah. That's all right. I'll plead the
I don't
fifth.
think
I'm
I'm
not
on
a
their
CPA.
radar yet.
Yeah, I'm not a CPA, so
Okay.
I won't answer that question. Yeah, I'll let someone smarter than myself answer that. But yeah. Yep.
So, when did you break out on your own and start your business? How old or what year was it? Do you know?
Yeah, it was just I had kind of started it, half-heartedly, but ultimately it wasn't till last year that I went full time. And so it hasn't been that long, but it's been a great ride so far. So I've been very blessed. A lot of good people have come my way and built a lot of great relationships. And so it's grown a lot faster than what I expected it to. I'm not a very good goal setter either. That's another thing I've never been very good at. So I was like, oh, let's just give it a whirl and see what happens. And so it's definitely exceeded my expectations and it's been great. And it was a very easy transition. One of my bigger regrets is not being entrepreneurial earlier. I was not raised that way. It was more like go to college, get a good job. But at the same time, what that did is it allowed me to get the experience that I need to do what I'm doing now. So if I started right out of college and said, hey, I'm going to be a CFO for small businesses, but I never had experience as a CFO or, actually in the real world, it'd have been a little tough. So in hindsight, it made sense that it had to happen in this order, because now I'm able to easily step into it and say, okay, well, this is all, I'm just doing what I've always done. I'm just helping a different group of people. So it's not, I'm not having to learn anything new except, a little bit about, my processes and my, procedures and things like that in terms of running a business. But so it's definitely a blessing and it's not a regret in that standpoint, in that sense. It's just hey, this is what paved the way for me to be where I'm at today. So yeah, it's been great, and it's gotten me in front of a lot of people I haven't been able to work with before or wouldn't have if I was still in the corporate world. And so that's been a huge blessing.
So would you say that this is a because I mean I certainly had never heard of a remote CFO before, and I may have just made that term up. I don't know, but is that kind of a newer concept, or is
Yeah, it is.
usually
It's yeah, it's it, there's been virtual CFOs out there is what a lot of people will call themselves. I know COVID escalated that quite a bit.
oh, that makes sense.
But there has always been this sort of fractional, I shouldn't say always, I don't know when it started, but it's been around for quite a while in terms of the fractional, you know, fractional basis. And when you look it up though, or when you see who's out there, it's still bigger companies that want to work with huge companies, right? So they want very few clients, very high paying clients, so that they can, you know, streamline everything. They don't get spread too thin. And so even on a fractional basis, if you're a small business looking for a fractional CFO, there's not a lot out there that are affordable, that are sort of catered to the small business. So I wanted to sort of take that idea and bring it to a, you know, change the business model a little bit where we can broaden our client base, but, you know, not have this huge requirement of, well, we're going to do all this crazy stuff and it's going to be, you know, $5,000 a month or whatever it is. It's like, no, we're going to make it a lot more affordable so we can help a lot more people. So it's definitely a balance, right? Like the more clients you have, the more you have to keep everything straight. Mm-hmm. And not get twisted up on who's doing what. So that's been a big challenge for me, is just keeping everything straight and documented. And so I know I'm very well prepared with each client when I'm going in. But the blessing side of that is the more things I get to see, the more I can share with the other clients and sort of say, hey, what if we did this? I've seen this done, you know, without giving away trade secrets and things like that. It's just like, hey, have you thought about this?
Yeah.
And what some of my other clients are doing, like, what if we packaged your pricing this way? You know, what if we did a different pricing strategy this way? So, yeah. You know, just different tips and tricks like that is definitely a value for them as well.
Mm-hmm. So I can just speak from my experience, just from when we started this journey together. I was just, you know, this is our third season back in business. That's a long story, another podcast, but basically we started this back up 3 years ago.
Yeah.
And I was just getting to the point when I met you where, okay, it's starting to show some real promise and some momentum, and we kind of had a shift coming, and I felt it because I've done this several times and I know what that feels like. So when we brought you on board, it was like almost preemptively, like I know what's coming and I know I'm going to be overwhelmed very soon. So yep. If I didn't bring you on board, I'm telling you, I wouldn't be where I am without a doubt, because I would have spent so much time and money trying to catch up instead of,
right,
you know, having the trajectory planned out, if you will. Yeah. So I've had this conversation with people before that were in that stage of business, and they say, I don't know if I can afford it. And my answer is, you can't afford not to have it. And I truly believe that. That's just my thoughts on hiring a, what'd you call it? A virtual CFO?
Yeah. Whatever you want to call it. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yep. That's a great point is, you know, it's tough to measure the ROI, because some of it is just in time saved, right? And again, back to your time and how valuable it is. But another thing is, it's hard without that fuel and without that person on the team to be able to, you know, scale and grow, right, and do it in an efficient way, that as quickly as possible, as efficiently as possible, without, you know, stepping in landmines and different things like that could have been avoided. So there's definitely an opportunity cost of it if you don't do it right. It's that's definitely a chicken and egg thing though, right? Because I work with a lot of people that are struggling to begin with, right? And so they're like, well, it's just another expense,
right?
And it's really not. It's an investment into, well, you can keep going the way you're going, or we can turn this thing around, right? And figure out what's going on and fix it, and in the long run, what's going to be better, right, for the business. So it's really a matter of sort of taking that leap of faith and saying, okay, well, this is what needs to happen, and I know it needs to happen, so let's do it.
Yep. So where do you go from here, Justin? What's next? Do you scale? Do you hire people to work for you? How's that work?
It's a great question. My business coach asked me that all the time. So my 5 to 10 year plan is the more challenging part will be replicating me with people that are super high quality, but also don't want to just go out and do it on their own. Right. And so it's finding that right person that I could, you know, offload some of the consulting pieces to. Right now I'm doing all that myself. I definitely, you know, we'll have more bookkeepers and things like that that can, if we, right. if we get clients, you know, if we get clients that aren't, you know, that need bookkeeping or that we do both for, then I can, you know, have someone grow and do that. And then definitely, you know, help on the sales side and things like that. But in terms of the actual strategic planning and the consulting, it's, I don't know exactly how that looks yet. So cool.
Maybe maybe delegate the sales side of it.
Yes. Oh, I will. I want to get a full-time salesperson, so I don't have to, you know, be that guy. 100% agree. I'm not the best salesperson in the world,
but just seems like it would be outside of your comfort zone a little bit.
Yeah. Yep. There's definitely people that
you sold me. You sold me. So
yeah. So yeah, we'll see. But it's back to goal planning and fighting those limiting beliefs and the negative self-talk and all that kind of stuff that every business owner deals with. Right. And so it's, I deal with the same stuff where it's like, how big can this really grow? You know, and is this good enough? And how many clients can I get? All that kind of stuff. So it's just, you know, trying to grow every single month, and hopefully I'll be better at setting that long-term goal soon. But right now that's kind of my vision, is to scale it so that I'm not so, you know, hands-on and in the business. Same as what we'd strive for you, right? Is how do we work on the business or over the business and not necessarily in it. So,
right.
It's the same journey that I'm on, you know, is what my clients are on.
Yeah. It's a different, vibe. There's a shift that occurs when you become your own boss. You know, it's all on you, right? Everything's on you. So what happens between the years is huge. Powerful stuff. And it'll either make you or break you.
Exactly.
Yeah. And so, you know, that the name of the podcast, Through the Noise, Business Life and Lies, that's the lies section. The lies is what's between the years and what you tell yourself and how you communicate with yourself, who you allow to communicate and speak into your life and who you think you are, your vision for yourself. So all that's big stuff.
Yep, for sure. It's a huge difference. And it, you know, really the core, what I've learned is you have to take care of yourself first, right? If you don't take care of yourself through, you know, exercise, good, you know, sleep habits and good, you know, reading positive things, surrounding yourself with positive people and people that are successful. If you don't take care of yourself and your own health, you know, physical, mental, et cetera, the business just suffers. And then, you know, you're not serving your employees well, you're not serving your clients well, you're not serving your family well. So it definitely all starts with you. And my business coach always goes back to that too, is how are you doing on your personal goals of just your health and your, you know, life balance? Cause it really does. It really impacts, and thoughts are super powerful. Right. And so it's really, you really have to be careful what you let get into your eyes and your ears and everything that you consume. Cause it definitely changes things, for the good or for the bad. So,
Who's your coach?
So it's a guy named John Passman. So I have, he was just referred to me by another friend. I was like, you know, here's kind of what I need. And so it's been a good relationship so far. And that's one of the things that really early on, I was like, I need a coach regardless. Cause I want just that extra accountability person, just like I am for my clients. Right. Where, you know, my clients who think that they, who do have a good understanding of finances and have it all, you know, figured out, it's helpful to have an outside perspective to say, hey, have you thought about it this way? Or maybe you're not doing as well as you think because you have confirmation bias and things like that. So I was like, I need someone to bounce these ideas off, because I've never been in this seat before, and I want to make sure I'm doing it the right way. And you know, what do I need to think about first? And just kind of organizing and focusing my thoughts and my actions to what's important. And so he's been a big help with that.
So I have monthly coach calls with my coach, Christian Partridge, which is Howard Partridge's son.
Yep.
And I had my call with him a few days ago, and I always go into those calls, especially this one, because it's April, our season's rocking, right? We're doing well. Yep. And I actually asked for you to send me a special P&L just to show him. And literally he looked at it for like 6 seconds was like, yeah, that's great. But how are you doing with this, 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 and this? And I was like, I guess I'm failing, you know, I got to get back to the grind. And so you're right. You need that. You need that accountability for somebody that has a aerial view of your company and what you're doing personally and can say, hey, you need to get back and focus on this. You said you were going to do this, go do it. Right. So
for sure.
But between you and my coach, it's a good thing I'm not afraid to spend money because, but you got to have it. I'm telling you guys, if you're listening out there and you don't have a coach and you don't have a CFO, unless you have a background like Justin Boyd, you need to rip the Band-Aid off and do it. It's like hiring an employee. It always feels uncomfortable when you go full time for the first employee, second employee. But you just have to do it, right? You got to get off the truck. You got to focus on what you're good at. And if what you're good at is being on the truck, well, I don't know. Maybe there's another conversation there. But dude, I appreciate your time. Give me give me one last punch and maybe plug yourself. How do we get a hold of you? Social media, what's the best way to get a hold of Boyd Executive Consulting?
Yeah, so BoydExecutiveConsulting.com on the socials. It's, you know, @JBoydCFO. You know, my website has all my contact information, so you can reach out. If you need to go through Trevor, that's fine, but you can find me. I'm available. I'm out there. Again, not great at social media, so don't judge me yet. My wife's helping me get a podcast going myself, and sort of that's my long-term goal, is to actually build an education platform where people can kind of go and have resources for themselves. I forgot to mention that. So that's one as well, as how do I, you know, distribute and, you know, give nuggets and give packages to people so they can kind of serve themselves to get up and running if they're not quite ready for the one-on-one coaching. And so that is part of the long-term growth, but yeah, she's helping me get there. We're working on it. That's how you get a hold of me.
Cool, man. All right. Yeah. It's @JBoydCFO. That's our social. Okay. Yep. I put it in the comments. Dude, I appreciate your time. And you know,
yeah,
I appreciate
thanks for having
your
me.
Your consistency. You never let me down.
Yeah.
I'm the one letting you down, but that's okay. No. We're gonna fix that too.
No, you're doing great. You're super respectable and care about your business a lot. So you're doing all right. But
I care.
Yep.
All right, brother. Thank you.
Well, appreciate it. Yeah, it's good to see you.
See ya.
All right, bye bye.
My issues up for all to see, like show and tell. A lot of people know me, but not a lot know me well. Hope my issues up for all to see, like show and tell. A lot of people know me, but they don't know me well.